Hello, and welcome to Haver, a Fife-based podcast series where we'll be discussing arts, culture, and anything else that crops up along the way. I'm Nicole Bell, former host of the Expressions podcast series for the 2015 Scottish Mental Health Arts and Film Festival, and a general arts festival worker in almost any shape, form, whatever.
And I'm Michael Grieve, a member of the improv comedy troupe Blind Mirth, and a dabbler in the dark arts of stand-up sketch and poetry. We will be your hosts on Haver today and most likely every single other time.
Today we'll be talking about two poetry events we attended in Fife, both part of this year's Book Week Scotland. The first was Miko Berry, current European and former Scottish slam poetry champion, loud poet and general crusader against boring poetry at Kirkcaldy Galleries.
And the second was the annual November event of Stanza, Scotland's international poetry festival, which was at Zest Cafe in St Andrews. It featured Andy Jackson and showcased Double Bill, an anthology of poems which was inspired by music, TV and film, which was published by Red Squirrel Press in 2014.
Book Week Scotland is a week-long celebration of reading and writing run by the Scottish Book Trust in November, demonstrating the diversity of Scotland's literary scene. And our experience of these two local events typifies the breadth and vivaciousness of the poetry community in Fife and beyond. So if we start, we'll talk about the Stanza event first.
Well, the Stanza event, essentially the way it worked was, in the room there were various people who had written for the anthology Double Bill.
Yep.
And they read poems that they had written and also poems from other writers in the anthology who weren't present. And Andy Jackson, who was
kind
the
of
editor.
Curated it. It almost felt like a curatory role that
yeah.
he played.
Yeah, I think he commissioned the poems from the poets and stuff as well. So he sort of took charge and he was running the tech, which there's a lovely slideshow with appropriate pictures and animations for the things being talked about.
Yeah.
I think one of the biggest things about that whole sort of process was just how fun it was, in the way that like you'd get poems just about stuff that perhaps we were not the target audience of, but I've definitely heard of and heard people speak about.
Yeah, we were a little, I think, young for the target audience,
yeah.
I might say, because it's pop culture from 60s, 70s,
like
80s?
Sort of latter half of the last century. And
yeah.
In a way that it was sort of a little bit like watching those TV shows where you get what it was like in the 80s, and like, but in verse. And
through a poetry lens.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So there was like a lot of the poems were genuinely like good poems and they were really like touching and quite serious, but none of it was sort of like po-faced ivory tower, I am a poet kind of poetry.
No, it was personal, it was genuine, it was...
Yeah, like there was Andy Jackson's wee poem about the clangers, which was the clanger tanka. The tanka is a Japanese form, it's sort of like an extended haiku. And Andy Jackson just got up on stage and he was like... for like 30 seconds.
And then he translated it. And I believe he probably did it right. I'm not sure he was improvising.
To be fair, I don't know of a good clanger dictionary. So I think he must be like some kind of native speaker.
Maybe he is.
He did the voice for the clanger.
That's his claim to fame. But this idea of fun, actually, is something that ties the two events that we went to together.
Yes,
I thought.
Definitely.
Because there was a definite sense of fun in Miko Berry's event.
Miko Berry, like, he had a two-hour set, so he like paced it very well throughout the whole night. And the first one he did, Tongue Tied, it's, about 5 minutes of him doing tongue twisters, but all sort of amalgamated into a speech.
One unified form.
Yeah, I think it's addressed to like somebody he fancies, and that's why he's tongue-tied.
Yeah, yeah.
And it sails quite close to the wind, because there's one about, there's a big section where he talks about being a pheasant plucker's son.
Can you say that again, Michael?
A pheasant plucker's son.
A pheasant plucker's son.
A pheasant plucker's son. And it is a pleasant poem about a pleasant pheasant plucker's son.
Excellent.
Is a lovely wee moment of watching him almost swear so much, so much, and he just always evades it. I feel like they should teach it to actors, do it with actors before they go on stage. Just the whole poem and everything.
Just that.
The enunciation is immense.
And usually, swearing wouldn't be that much of a problem. But this comes from Miko Berry's kind of history or what he does now.
Yeah.
He's an educator with kids.
He goes into schools.
He
sort of, he runs slams, he runs poetry workshops, and he was talking about, just before performing that poem actually, how hilarious it is to watch teachers' faces as he performs that poem.
I imagine that is quite good. Yeah.
He goes into primary schools more than, he does secondary as well, I think, but I think he does some of both, which is just a lovely little moment of him, like,
the watching the teacher squirm.
Yeah. The work he does with children seems to be, I think, something he really enjoys and something he really, really engages with. Because there's a young woman there, actually. There was a moment in the night at the Kirkcaldy Galleries where Miko Berry offered the mic up to the audience. And a young girl called Imogen got up and read Holly Painter's poem,
Weapon of Choice.
Yes. And it... which is on YouTube if you want to look at it, see the poem. But Imogen got up and performed her version of the poem, essentially. She performed it without paper. There was no reading from paper. There was no tweeter. There was no boring poetry, as the description for Miko Berry's event stated there would not be. It was a lovely wee moment.
And she was fantastic.
Really,
she was
really
so confident and capable. And I wish I had half that confidence at her age. I'm not sure how old she was, but... what, 13, 14, 15?
Yeah, 13, 14, something. I think. Something like that.
She was just fantastic. And what this poem was dealing with was cyberbullying. I'm not going to go too into detail with it because you can see it online. But it was really a poignant poem.
I think the nicest thing about it was the fact that Miko, like, sort of offered up that space in his show.
Yeah.
He literally said, if any of you want to get up here and read a poem, go for it. And...
she was the only one that took him up, which was a shame, I think.
He did do a lot of... I think that is testament to his commitment to breaking down the barrier with the audience, though. Like,
yeah.
Like, all the way through it, he was sort of talking to us and trying to talk with us. He would ask questions and expect a response, and...
It was a conversation. It wasn't just a one-way show.
Very much so, very much so.
And in some ways, actually, the Stanza event didn't really feel like a one-way show either. I think it was more in that there wasn't a direct conversation or a discourse with the audience, if you like, but because it was so intimate and it felt really personal. And
I think because this is like the anthology is something that is the outcome of some kind of communal effort in which Andy Jackson has spoken to people and organised this volume, and they've all like got together to do events, they read each other's poems as well as they read their own. It feels like the people who have been involved in the process of making Double Bill are all sort of in a little community, and then during that event you're sort of pulled into that with them.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's sort of them saying, come along with us, let's go do it all together. And that was really nice, I think.
And this is the kind of thing, actually, that on the whole, Stanzas Festival actually does very well.
Yes.
So Stanzas Festival takes place in March every year, the beginning of March. And obviously you've got your classic kind of events where you go and see someone who's really quite renowned and you enjoy it, and you might get a kind of Q&A session or something after. But you also have open mic events.
Yes.
And these kind of things where it's about, you know, every part of the community and the poetry community and being part of it.
Well, I think it's what's nice about Stanza. Like, it's all sort of in the tagline, you know, it's Scotland's International Poetry Festival, and it's the fact that it's St Andrews is just sort of this wee tiny town in Fife, way in the middle of nowhere, and it's one of the biggest poetry festivals sort of happening. Like, it just, everyone sort of descends upon the town for a 3-day binge of rhyme. And you get this sort of wonderful thing where you meet people, and because everyone goes to the events, and it's... I feel like that, like, the Double Bill event really, I think, was in that sort of world of everyone was there together. It wasn't lots of people going to see some poetry. It was sort of everyone going to engage with poetry. In a, like, because the poems were about ABBA and Van Morrison. And
the way that kind of pop culture is a shared thing, a communal thing, it kind of replicated that in its form. It's about a shared thing, a communal thing.
And, like, there was a point in it where I was, as a member of the audience, was handed a sheet of paper and told to shout these lines at these points, just to, like, add to the effect of the poem.
Yeah.
By people I don't know and will probably not know. Just this wonderful moment of just being told to do it, and because you're all there together, you shout the thing and you suddenly become part of this performance you were previously watching, and it sort of really breaks down that moment, that thing of going the people on stage and the people in the audience, in a way that forges the community as well as sort of continuing it, very similar to how Miko Berry forges it in his kind of engagement with young people, which I think comes from a similar space as the pop culture stuff in mm-hmm. Double Bill.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And what we should mention about the young people at Miko Berry's event was that there were a plethora of young people. One person actually had to get up and leave for a bus before the end of the show.
Which he did make a joke about, I think.
He made a joke about it. It was hilarious, though. It was nice. It was lighthearted. And, you know, they were in a school blazer, and they kind of left to get their bus home. And that's somebody that's come from school, waited for this event before they've gone home, and it's really nice to see that engagement from young people.
See, we'll go to a poetry event just for fun. It's that, 'cause I think that's ultimately what it's about. It's about making people sit up and listen to you, which is so evident in the content of Miko Berry's poetry, which is a whole world.
Yeah, there is so much. There is so much that could be said about the content of that poetry. There was not a stone Miko Berry was unwilling to kind of leave untouched.
I think the whole point of it was just that he was being like honest about his experience with so many things, whether that was a sort of current affairs news story or a
mental health issues.
And then like broader political issues. Like, he had a lovely wee poem called the P word about tampon tax, which is just a very witty response to some draconian tax law. Like,
and it was so nice to see somebody stand up on a platform and have that discussion out.
Very openly. Very,
very openly. Very comfortably.
Yeah. I think comfy, actually, is one of the nicest things about both of the events.
Yeah.
And Miko Berry's was comfy while discussing things that are usually not that comfortable.
Yeah. Like, race. We had our stuff about race come up as well.
Yeah. And I think Miko told a story on stage about when he was going to perform one of his poems in a school, and it was about self-harm, and the teachers tried to discourage him from doing the poem because there were people at the school who were sort of having issues with mental health and with self-harming. And Miko's whole point is that, but if we don't do the poem, then nobody's helping. Yeah. You have to speak about it and be honest about your experience. And I think that sort of extending the hand across the bridge between, like, the space between the stage and the audience, he reaches his hand across it and you have to go over and clasp it back and like really grab onto what he's saying and think about it and hold it. And the craft of his poems, I think, really help you do that.
And he kind of shared some of his kind of crafting process along the way too, which was really nice. We got great insight into his sort of artistic experience, if you want, while he's going through writing a poem.
Well, he put so much emphasis on the time it takes him. Nobody was under any illusions that these were frittered off in a moment on a train before a gig kind of thing. And even though they sound like that often, they sound
effortless. Sound effortless, but effortless is not the experience of writing them, which I think is something as almost a consumer, if you want, of these kind of things sometimes.
Yeah.
You lose sight of that
to
some extent. But I'm not somebody that writes stuff very often. Mm-hmm. And so as somebody that doesn't have that kind of visual when I'm looking at somebody else's work, you forget that this is something that's taken them months, years even, to put together. And it's good to have that insight.
And I think that's especially true with poetry in the sort of slammy style that Miko does, in that I feel like there's a certain sense of, if you're sitting down to read a sonnet, you're aware of it being a sonnet and know that some work has gone in to make it look like a sonnet.
Yeah.
Whereas this slam stuff sounds like it's just somebody on a stage just like shouting things and words happen to rhyme. But actually, I think the way the rhymes sort of slot together and move together, and I think the Tongue Twister poem is a great example of how the sounds all just mash up so well together that they just stick in your head and they just pull you along, and it's like you're in your chair and then this man just gets up on a stage and starts shouting at you about something and you're just immediately barreled into by it. And it's beautiful as an experience to share that with all the people in the room when it is such an open thing.
And we want to make sure that, you know, the Haver community, if you like, goes out and sees these online, listens to them online, because it's not enough us just talking about it. Have to hear fabulous.
Go watch Miko Berry right now. There's a link in the description.
Go right now. We'll include that so you can definitely have a listen. They're worth your time.
Yeah, and like the foundations, I think, that sort of engagement with something like poetry creates, in the sense that the people who go to a Miko Berry show might be the people who end up in a version of Double Bill, who might. Like the events, I think, are sort of different processes in the same community. Like there's.
So it's different steps along the timeline, almost.
Yeah.
Almost.
Double Bill's almost like a celebration of all the things that are and creating within that.
And Miko Berry's almost trying to inspire. I mean, he does it so well, but by the
Yeah.
fact he does it so well, he tries to inspire that in other people. And seeing him get up and do it makes you want to get up and do something too.
Especially when he speaks about the work he does in schools, and he just gets people to like write poems on a day, and then they have a slam, and that sort of just there's this immediate spur, the moment of creating something and going into something further, and like comparing with each other, talking to each other about it, engaging in the process as a group of people all doing it, rather than somebody sitting in their room, like sort of writing a poem and not showing it to anyone. It makes the creative process. It's not about it failing or it being amazing. It's about that sort of feedback loop. If you do something and then you learn from that and you pull this back and you do it again and you keep doing that until you really know how to express yourself and deal with all the things going on in your mind, which is what Miko Berry's poetry essentially deals with, is the stuff that's rollicking around in people's heads a lot.
Yeah, and the stuff that needs talked about more.
Yes.
And the fact that he brings it to the fore already, you've almost had a discussion in a room that you
Yeah.
feel like you might never have had otherwise.
Yeah, in a way that for a place like Kirkcaldy, where engagement with arts and culture.
Can be quite disappointing
Yeah,
at times, I think.
it's really nice to see something so fresh and exciting happening in the town.
And people be so highly engaged in it.
Yeah.
But I think this is a move that Kirkcaldy, particularly the library or the gallery, do we call it now? The
It's a
gallery?
library and the gallery, I suppose. I don't know.
The library gallery,
Yeah.
that's something that they're trying to do.
The youth librarian
Yeah.
was at the event and he was talking about potentially starting up a sort of book cafe thing for teenagers that's sort of about, I think, quite a casual space for young people to read books and talk about books and engage in other sort of creative things that they want to do, and making that a thing that happens regularly and sort of fosters a community of the arts for the young people in Fife, I think is a great thing.
And the fact that we've seen, well, we've had all this come out about the library closures in Fife,
Yeah.
we want these things to take off,
Less
you know?
closure.
Less closure. No closure.
Exactly.
That is an event that we had that, in many ways, like I went away from Miko Berry's event, I was really thinking about things, and it was just a journey I might not have had otherwise. And if the library had been shut, I certainly wouldn't
And
have had it, and that would
also,
have been a great
sort
one.
of like leaving the event really excited just about going and doing things in the world. Like seeing Miko Berry as a person who is from Kirkcaldy, who grew up there, who went
Has
to
been
school there, and is now.
all over the world
Yeah.
doing slam poetry awesomely.
Yeah. And it's great. And it's I think that is a sort of important thing that we also see in the Stanza event because of where it was. Zest Cafe in St Andrews has a great record on this kind of stuff.
They've won multiple awards, and they're really good at giving employment opportunities to people who wouldn't have had these opportunities otherwise, or have had difficulty in getting these through disability or personal
Yeah.
circumstances, which is fabulous. And it's a place in the community that wants you to be part of its community, it to be part of the community. Anybody can go and host their event there. You can book it on their website. It's great.
And I think like that is probably the biggest thing that you get from both of these events. Like as much as Book Week Scotland is a massive thing and we only went to these two things in a very specific area and they were both poetry,
Yeah.
both have this great sense of the arts bringing and making and building on a community in more ways than just the community of the arts. I think they both sort of were involved in sort of a feeding back into the community more generally
Yeah.
and about trying to pull people into that and constantly pull it all together in that way. And that's all for this Haver. Thank you for joining us for this podcast. We hope you have enjoyed it. And if you have, you can find us on all the usual social networks. And if you really want, subscribe to us on YouTube. There are links in the description. And always feel free to get in touch if there's anything else you'd like us to Haver about in the future.
Don't forget to check out all the people, projects and poems we've mentioned in this episode. Again, there will be links in the description. We'll be back soon for the next Haver.